Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you again today. Welcome to Worship and the Word with us here at Church of the True Vine. May God bless you today as we spend this time together. Psalm 121 says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your coming in and your going out from this time forth and even forevermore. We have a wonderful, wonderful God. He is our keeper. He is our shade at our right hand, and he preserves our soul. That is so good to know. In these days in which we live, where everything seems uncertain, where everything seems rocky, where nations are being shaken, we have God who preserves our soul, our mind, our will, our emotions, and keeps us on the right course, on the right path, and enables us to stand strong in these days. We're going to be praying later on this morning. We continue to pray for the nation of Ukraine, and we pray regarding this awful conflict that is going on over there. We're praying that this war will come to a speedy conclusion and that righteousness will prevail. So please join with us as we pray regarding the war in Ukraine. And also, as every week, we are praying for a different nation around the world where Christians are persecuted for their faith. This week, we're praying for the nation of Oman. And I'm going to read to you from the World Watchlist booklet regarding the nation of Oman. It says this: like other countries in the Arabian Peninsula, the extent to which Christians in Oman are persecuted depends mostly on status and nationality. Converts from Islam encounter the greatest opposition, both from families and wider society. Believers could be thrown out of home, separated from their children, disinherited, or left jobless. Expatriate Christian communities are mostly tolerated, but they do experience restrictions and surveillance. Proselytizing is illegal. Christians active in evangelism have been put under pressure to leave the country. It's tough to be a Christian in the nation of Oman, so please join with us as we pray for our brothers and sisters in that land. But now let's turn our attention to praising our God who preserves our soul, our God who is the maker of heaven and earth, who does not slumber nor sleep. We're going to be singing together now that great, great old hymn, How Great Thou Art. God bless you as we worship him today.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, Lord. We come before you now with our prayers and petitions towards you. But first of all, Lord, I just want to thank you that your mercies are new every morning. That, Lord, we thank you for your love and your faithfulness towards us. And that, Lord, we know that you are a solid rock, a firm foundation on which we can build our lives. It says in your word that your word is eternal, that, Lord, it stands forever, and that you never change. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And Lord, I want to pray right now for people who are feeling anxious, worried, and fearful in these changing times at the moment. Lord, you say in your word in Matthew, not to worry, because you will care for us. We don't have to worry about what we will eat or what we will drink or who will clothe us, because you love us so much. And that, Lord, you tell us not to be anxious or worry about anything, but if we bring our prayers and requests before you, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge of Christ Jesus. And Lord, I just pray for that peace, that indescribable peace, that shalom of God that is beyond our understanding, will come upon people who are anxious and fearful at this moment through these changing and turbulent times. Lord, I pray by your Holy Spirit that anxiety will go, that they will know they are dearly loved, and that, Lord, there is no need to worry. And Lord, we pray also for the country of Ukraine that is torn by war at the moment. Lord, we pray for peace in that land, and we pray for comfort to all those who mourn, all those who have lost their dwelling places, have been uprooted and their lives dramatically changed. Lord, we pray for a quick resolution to this conflict, and we pray for your love and your peace, and we pray for those brothers and sisters in Christ who are spreading your word in that land, that they may be seen as a beacon of light amongst the devastation that is going on. And Father, we pray also for countries that have been hit by natural disasters, for Pakistan where there is the flooding, and particularly for Florida where there was the hurricane last week. And Father, we pray for all those who have lost their dwelling places, who have lost lives or lost loved ones, that Lord, you will comfort them, that Lord, they will find shelter quickly, and that Lord, they may be able to rebuild their lives. But above all, Lord, I pray that you will turn these situations for good, and that Lord, people will know more of your peace, know more of your love, and more of your provision through these disasters. And Lord, we come also to pray for our brothers and sisters in the country of Oman. Lord, we pray for those who are finding hardship because they have turned towards Christ, turned towards Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the work of Open Doors and other Christian agencies who are going in there and encouraging believers there with teaching. And we pray for pastors there, that you will strengthen them, that they will know of your love. And Lord, we pray for protection for all believers there, that yes, you will strengthen them and protect them each and every day. And Lord, we pray for the Sultan, that Lord, he may have a change of heart, and that he will become favourable towards those of minority religions in the land. Lord, we pray for a turning towards you, a move of your Holy Spirit in that land, that more will come to know you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Today I'll be reading to you from Book of John, chapter 19, verses 5 to 12. When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jews insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law he must die, because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and he went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus, but Jesus gave him no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said, "Don't you realize I have the power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jews kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar."
You know, every so often, a passage of scripture which you have read countless times suddenly kind of reaches out to you and grabs you in a fresh way, and it kind of takes you by surprise. And as I was preparing this message for this broadcast, I knew I needed to speak from this passage in John 19. But as I was reading it afresh and meditating on it and thinking about it, suddenly it caught me in a way that I simply was not expecting. We'll come to that in just a little while. But just before I do, let's set the scene as to what is going on here. Jesus, we know, has been betrayed by one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot. And then he has been arrested. He has been put on a mock trial, a trial which actually was illegal. And he has been condemned to death by the Jewish leaders. They have said he is worthy of death. But they said, no, we're going to send him to Pontius Pilate and we're going to have him crucified. And so Jesus has appeared before Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate has asked the crowd, who do you want me to set free in accordance with the Passover tradition? Do you want me to release Jesus to you or Barabbas, a murderer, to you? And the crowd have demanded the release of Barabbas. So Barabbas has been released. And Pilate has then handed Jesus over to be scourged. And so Jesus now is standing before Pontius Pilate again, having been scourged. He is in a dreadfully weakened state. His body has been ripped open by that cat of nine tails, or those cat of nine tails that the Romans have used. His spine is exposed. His internal organs are exposed. He is absolutely mutilated at this point. And here he stands before Pontius Pilate, who is at the time the most powerful person in the region, naturally speaking. Pontius Pilate is a man who Tacitus and other historians wrote about. We know that that Pontius Pilate was a real person. He had a reputation for great cruelty. And Jesus stands before this man, the man who is the governor in Judea, the man who has the express authority of the emperor himself. He is the most powerful man in the region, naturally speaking, at this time. And Jesus stands before him in this dreadfully weakened state, his body ripped apart. And Pilate asks Jesus this question: are you not speaking to me? Don't you realize who you are talking to? Don't you realize that I am the one who has the final say here? Don't you realize that in this region, at this moment, there is no higher authority? I am the one who has power to crucify you and who has the power to release you. Don't you realize that I am the one who has the power to make that decision? Look at yourself. You're in this terrible state. You have been torn apart. But I am the one who has the say now as to whether you go free or whether you go to the cross. And Jesus, you can just picture Jesus looking Pilate straight in the eye as he gives him his answer. You could have no power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me to you has the greater sin. You could have no power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above. You see, Pontius Pilate can only see things from a worldly point of view. He can only see things from the status that he enjoys as the governor of Judea. He can only see it through natural eyes. And he, naturally speaking, as we've already said, is the one who can say, crucify him or let him go free. Well, he's already had one go at setting Jesus free, and the crowd have demanded Barabbas. But Pilate still holds to this belief that he is the one who calls the shots in this situation. But Jesus says to him, you would have no power at all over me unless it had been given to you from above. Now, the thing about this, I want you to look at what Pilate actually says to Jesus, because it's very, very telling. You know, God allows certain words to be spoken very specifically at points in the Bible. And what Pilate asks Jesus is very specific. He asks him, do you not know that I have power to crucify you and power to release you? He doesn't say, do you not realize that I have the power to have you put to death? He doesn't say, "Do you not realize that I have the power to execute you?" He doesn't say that. He specifically says, "Do you not realize that I have the power to crucify you?" Why is that so important? Well, it's important. When you turn to Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13, the Apostle Paul says this: "Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree.'" Note that. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. The cross, the crucifix, was also known as the tree. Many of the crosses themselves were basically just uprooted trees with the branches cut off and nailed alongside. They weren't these nice shaped pieces of wood that we think of when we look at religious pictures and paintings. Sometimes they were as crude as just a tree with the branch taken off and nailed across. So this is speaking of the tree, speaking of the cross. And Pilate says, "Do you not know that I have power to crucify you?" Remember, cursed is everyone who hangs upon a tree. Pilate does not realize fully what he is saying. Pilate is saying, "Do you not realize that I am the one who has the power to put you in a position where you come under a curse according to the law of Moses, according to the law that the Jewish people followed, according to the law that Jesus said, 'I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill.'" Pilate says, "Don't you realize that I have the power to crucify you, to put you into a place of cursing, or the power to set you free?" Jesus says, "You would have no power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above." Pilate had no authority to place Jesus in a position of being cursed. If you turn to Proverbs and chapter 26, verse 2 of Proverbs 26 says, "Like a flitting sparrow, like a flying swallow, so a curse without cause shall not alight." Jesus said of himself, "The God of this world has nothing in me." Jesus was the spotless, sinless Lamb of God. This is how it tells us that in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21, God made him who had no sin to be made sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus was without sin. The devil, the god of this world, had nothing in him. It was like the devil had no landing strip in Jesus's life. And in Proverbs 26, it tells us that a curse cannot land upon somebody without cause. In other words, a curse has to have the legal authority to be able to land upon somebody's life. Jesus is the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. A curse has no place in his life. The devil had no authority to bring cursing upon Jesus, and Pilate had no authority to bring a curse upon Jesus. So how is it that this passage of scripture in John 19 hit me in a fresh way? It hit me in a fresh way because suddenly I saw the magnificence of the grace of God. I saw the sheer glory of how great the love of God toward mankind is. When we see Jesus, the one through whom all things were made, the one without whom nothing was made that has been made, humbling himself to this position where he allows himself to be put to death for us, to be put in the position of becoming a curse for us. Jesus, the one who never deserved cursing, the one who actually deserves nothing else except glory and praise and honour and thanksgiving has come. The Word of God has become flesh and made his dwelling among us. There was no man, there was no demon, there was no authority in this earth that had any power over him whatsoever. And yet we see Jesus willingly coming to this place where he submits himself. Note that he submits himself to the authority of Pontius Pilate in allowing himself to become a curse for us. Pilate actually had no say in what went on here. Pilate says, I have the authority either to crucify you or to set you free. But Pilate has no authority in this situation whatsoever. We know that because straight after this, it says, from then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, if you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend. Whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar. Pilate tried to let him go. He'd already tried to let him go once, and the crowd had demanded Barabbas. Here again, Pilate seeks to release him, but the Jews cry out, and they say, you will not be a friend of Caesar if you let this man go. Pilate only had the authority that God gave him at that time, and God used the authority that he gave to Pilate to send Jesus to the cross. Jesus went willingly to the cross. Just turn back to John chapter 10 and verse 11. And I'm going to read the whole of this passage. Verse 11 of John chapter 10. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, so I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. Pontius Pilate believed he had authority. If Jesus had so desired, he could have called on the Father, and the Father would instantly have sent 12 legions of angels to rescue him. But Jesus willingly laid down his life. There was no man, no demon, no power, no authority that had any sway unless God allowed it, unless Jesus himself allowed it. This is the grace of God. The one who has all power, the one who has all authority, willingly, in this brief moment of time, gave authority to Pontius Pilate so that Pontius Pilate would send him to the cross, would send him to the place of cursing, so that Jesus could redeem us from the curse of the law. If you want to know more about what the curse of the law is, then read Deuteronomy chapter 28. In the curse of the law, there is sickness, there is oppression, there is mental torment, there is defeat, there is failure. All of these things come under the curse of the law. Read Deuteronomy 28. I haven't got the time here to read all of it. It's a comprehensive list of pretty much every terrible thing that can happen. But Christ came and he died on the cross. Cursed is everyone who hangs upon a tree. And Jesus willingly hung upon the tree, hung upon the cross to set us free from the curse of the law. He allowed Pilate to crucify him. He allowed Pilate to send him to that place so that Jesus could become a curse for us in our place, to redeem us, to buy us back from the curse of the law. This is the grace of God toward us. This is the love of God toward us. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Do you know that you have everlasting life today? Have you received that gift of everlasting life? It is a gift. It is available to everybody, but you have to receive it. Otherwise, it's like just putting a wrapped parcel on a shelf and saying, thank you very much, that's very kind, but you never find out what's inside. You never receive the benefit. But you can receive the benefit that God offers you today. He offers you the gift of everlasting life if you will come to Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And Jesus' own definition of everlasting life is knowing God the Father and Jesus Christ, who he sent. Jesus is the only way to the Father. Will you surrender your life to him today? That is what coming to Christ means. It doesn't just mean praying a little prayer and thinking, that's it, I've signed off my eternal insurance papers. It means coming and confessing Jesus as Lord. Confessing him as Lord means making him Lord of your life. It's his will that goes, not yours. It's his will for your life that goes. The Bible says, if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, then you will be saved. That means if you believe it in here and you are willing to surrender to him and ask him to save you and ask him to be the Lord of your life, then at that moment you will receive the gift of everlasting life through Jesus Christ. So will you come today? Do you believe that God has raised Jesus from the dead? If you do, then just take the next step. Confess Jesus as Lord. Ask him to be the Lord of your life. Turn away from being the Lord of your own life. Turn away from the path of sin. Turn away from everything that would prevent you from entering in to the kingdom of heaven and everlasting life. And follow Jesus with everything you've got. If that's what you want to do, then pray this prayer with me. Praying the prayer in itself will not save you. Remember, this is a declaration of what is going on in your heart. You are surrendering your life to Jesus Christ. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you became a curse for me, that you died on the cross in my place. I believe that you are the Son of God. I thank you, Jesus, that you were the sinless one who became sin for me and died on the cross in my place. I believe, Jesus, that you are risen from the dead. And so I ask you, Jesus, to be Lord of my life. I surrender my life to you, Jesus. I ask you to be my Lord. I turn to you with all my heart. I turn away from sin. I choose to die to sin so that I can live life to God. I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit to enable me and empower me to live this new life that you have given me. And I thank you, Jesus, that you have saved even me. I will love you and serve you as best as I can for the rest of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving even me. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer and you have really meant it, you have surrendered your life to Christ, you have just begun a wonderful new adventure, a wonderful new life that you will never regret living. But Jesus says, confess me before men. He said, if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. So there's something else I just want you to do. This will not guarantee yours. Your salvation is guaranteed. The moment you surrendered your life to Christ, your salvation was guaranteed. But Jesus says, if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. So please get in touch. Let us know that you have prayed and asked Jesus to become the Lord of your life. And we will pray with you. We will help you. We will encourage you in whatever way we can. And tell the people you know, if you know Christians, let them know that you have surrendered your life to Christ and decided to follow Jesus. And they will help you too. They will encourage you. They will pray with you and encourage you in whatever way they can. If you're anywhere in the Clevedon area, then why not come and join us at the community centre? We meet at the community centre on Prince's Road at 10:30 every Sunday morning. If you're not in the Clevedon area, then please just get in touch anyway and let us know that you have decided to become a follower of Jesus Christ. We would love to hear from you. We're back again on YouTube at the same time next week. That's 10 a.m. UK time. Be great if you could join us then, or of course you can always catch up later on demand. So until next week, may God bless you richly. May you know his joy, his peace, and his love at all times and in all ways. Until next week, God bless you. Bye bye.